This video is about being open and exploring creative possibilities and not getting stuck in formulaic tedium. The great thing about being a freelance creator is there really are no limits. You can do what you want. There will be small consequences, but work-wise, your clients are not all in one basket. If you're working for a corporate entity, you have a line manager. Everything has to be discussed with your immediate superior. Companies and institutions tend to be conservative by nature and work under the adage that if it ain't broke, we're not going to fix it. So anything new and novel is discouraged. Sadly, many photographers fall into this trap. They happen upon a style that after some time working brings them some success, some material reward and status, and feel compelled to milk that style, to formulaically repeat themselves ad nauseam for the rest of their career. It's understandable. We all have a living to make, and there is comfort in repetition, but after a while, the work becomes dull, an empty exercise in stamping your subject with technique. Don't get me wrong, I think it's important to master the craft, but we shouldn't be a slave to what has worked in the past. We should be open to trying new things. The Cocteau Twins, 1993. I shot this enigmatic band in Richmond, West London, on colour infrared film. I also used a rather enigmatic camera, a horizon swing lens panoramic. It was a combination of film and camera that I've never used since. The first time I came across infrared black and white film, I was a 19-year-old in my second year at college studying photography. The first year I messed around. I swam in the sea, I played snooker on Union Street, it was in Plymouth, and then something happened, something clicked. I became suddenly obsessed with the medium. I became part of a clique of students who were very competitive. We would stand by the machine that would process the Ilford multi-grade prints, 10 by 8s, and wait for them to be spat out. We'd be looking at other people's work. We'd yet to discover the joys of fiber-based printing, lith printing, selenium toning. We were just printing these little black and white 8x10s, and then we'd laminate them and put them in our portfolio. And infrared was a way of maybe giving me an edge, maybe getting talked about by the other students. So one winter morning, I woke up to a blanket of deep snow. Maybe this was my opportunity to combine what was already a compelling kind of visual spectacle with the infrared film. I loaded the camera in the dark room. It was so sensitive to light, and headed out onto the treacherous, slippery Dartmoor roads to take some pictures. I shot rocks, hedges, and plants poking through the stark, icy landscape. When I got back to college, I still had film in the camera, so I shot a couple of portraits of my classmates, John and Anna. It's funny to think, looking at these pictures, that these people are now in their 50s and 60s. I guess that's the magic of photography. I probably would have used a filter. It might have been a red one, but I can't remember. It's too long ago. There's no metadata, there's no notes, contemporaneous notes. That's something that I would urge photographers to do, is keep a journal, keep a record, especially if you're shooting on film. Because if you do want to kind of recreate something or work out what went right or wrong, you have no evidence if you didn't write anything down. Were the pictures any good? I'll let you decide. I think they're okay for a 19-year-old. They're quite simple and graphic. And I obviously thought so at the time, otherwise I wouldn't have printed them up. So 7 years pass, and so much has happened. I've swapped the lonely Devon moors for the busy streets of London. And I'm working for the music press, the NME, Q, and Select, for which I've been commissioned to photograph the Cocteau Twins. I decide that my infrared odyssey shall continue. I learn about this lab that is able to undertake the rather esoteric process of E4, the means by which you develop a color infrared ektachrome transparency. They are called Argentum, and they're in the center of London at 1 Wimpole Street. My preferred camera back then was medium format, but I don't think they made a medium format color infrared film at that point. Hence my decision to hire the Horizon panoramic camera and thereby get effectively, although it used 35 millimeter, a bigger negative, which was obviously going to be better quality. I took some self-portraits with the hire camera the night before and developed them in my dark room, just to check that everything was working as it should. We shot in a park adjacent to the River Thames, and the band showed a fair degree of patience as I faffed around with all these different cameras. Obviously, I was shooting on the Horizon, but I had no intention of putting all my photographic eggs in one basket. So I had all these other cameras, and I guess my adage was that if you throw enough mud at the wall, some of it will stick. It was in the days before digital. If you wanted a variety of looks, you had to create that by using different film stocks. And as well as the infrared, I used 4 different other film stocks, including Tri-X, normal color transparency. But interestingly, I used Kodacolor Gold, which was an amateur 35 millimeter negative film. I'd put it through an E6 process, a cross process, at +2. And when you exposed it, you had to use an 81 EF very warm filter, but it gave wonderful skin tones. I did some headshots using that. The group shots I shot on my dynamic duo of my Hasselblad and my Fuji 6.9 rangefinder. And I went back to what I knew would work, because it's important to give the magazine what they're expecting before you go off piste and do something a bit crazy. Looking at the infrared images now, they're pretty poor quality. But when you consider that the film was developed by the US military for camouflage detection during World War II, it's quite old technology. So the film stock is rather grainy. The camera is quite basic too. It was invented in 1948, and I don't think the design has changed that much. Completely clockwork. I think I struggled to get the filter, which I must have used, onto the front of the lens. I'd say on the whole that my infrared color setup was pretty agricultural. And at the time I was obsessed with sharpness, and the kind of lack of focus would have been a real problem for me. The images I would have regarded as a failure, and certainly they wouldn't have found their way anywhere near my portfolio or even syndication. But now I look at them and I'm more relaxed about things being a bit blurry. And I think they're kind of distinctive in their own way. I've no idea whether they were reproduced by Select at the time. They probably went with the straighter pictures, if only because it's very difficult to lay out an extremely horizontal panoramic photograph in a magazine. But if anyone does have a copy of 1993 Select, the Cocteau Twins edition, let us know.